So, while Pavlov was studying the automatic salivating response his dogs had to meat powder, he unexpectedly discovered that his dogs began to salivate to things that they wouldn't normally salivate to. For example, Pavlov's dogs started to salivate to the presence of the research assistant who brought the meat powder into the laboratory. They even started salivating to the sounds of the research assistant's footsteps as the assistant approached the laboratory. Therefore, Pavlov's dogs seemed to have anticipated the meat powder and responded to previously neutral stimuli that were associated with the arrival of the meat powder. Pavlov wanted to know if he could train his dogs to elicit the same salivating response to other stimuli that wouldn't naturally elicit salivating responses from dogs. For example, a clicking metronome. Pavlov started with an initially neutral stimulus, the clicking metronome. He then paired the clicking metronome with an unconditioned stimulus that elicited an automatic unconditioned salivating response, the meat powder. Pavlov then repeatedly paired the clicking metronome with the meat powder. Over a short period of time, Pavlov's dogs demonstrated salivating responses to the presentation of the metronome alone because they had made an association between the metronome and the meat powder. This is classical conditioning. Because Pavlov's dogs were trained to salivate to the clicking metronome, the metronome becomes the conditioned stimulus, and the salivating response to the metronome becomes the conditioned response. Because dogs don't naturally salivate to clicking metronomes. So, Pavlov showed us that animal behaviour could be trained or learned using the principles of classical conditioning. The next big question for behaviourists was, is the same true for humans? In a famous, though ethically dubious experiment, Watson and Rayner in 1920 showed that it was possible to train a human child to respond with fear and distress. Little Albert was a 9-month-old infant who was shown a white rat, a rabbit, a monkey, and various masks. But Albert displayed no observable fear in response to any of these stimuli. In other words, these stimuli weren't unconditioned stimuli that elicited unconditioned responses. So not like Pavlov's dogs salivating to the meat powder. Watson and Rayner did find an unconditioned stimulus, however. They realised that when a hammer was banged against a steel gong behind little Albert's head, little Albert would cry in distress. In the study, Watson and Rayner first allowed little Albert to play with a white rat. Then Watson and Rayner snuck up behind little Albert and struck a steel gong with a hammer only seconds after the rat was shown to little Albert. After 7 pairings of the rat and the loud, unpleasant sounds from the gong, little Albert displayed a conditioned crying response to the conditioned rat stimulus alone. Even by the 5th day of the study, little Albert only had to see the white rat to immediately show fear, distress, and crying, regardless of whether or not the gong was hit. The white rat had become a conditioned stimulus that elicited the conditioned response of fear and distress in little Albert. Watson and Rayner also found that little Albert developed fear towards stimuli or objects which shared characteristics with the white rat. For example, a rabbit, a dog, and a fur coat. This process is now referred to as stimulus generalisation.